chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. In the time of Herod, of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is the child who has been born the King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means the least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you've found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went that star they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. May God add his blessing to the hearing and understanding of his word.
I told you it was coming. Who's going to pray for the preacher this morning? Doesn't have to be long, doesn't have to be eloquent, but somebody's going to pray for me every Sunday. Who's it going to be today? Look, everybody's looking around like you're in the third grade. I'm invisible. She can't see me. Surely somebody can say a short prayer for the preacher this morning. Who will? Thank you, Neil. Come up to the microphone if you would. Can you come up to the microphone? Thank you. Hey there.
Let us pray for Terri. Dear Father in heaven, help her through this troubled time. Give strength to her and watch over her mother, Addie. And also, please take care of her dog as well. And and take care of any upcoming issues with her arm or her knee, and also her back. thank you, Lord, for looking over.
Amen. See, that wasn't hard, was it? I keep telling you, remember the guy, the lay leader at my last congregation, who stood up and said, "Please bless our pastor with common sense this morning as she preaches." It's my husband's favorite of all time, of all the prayers for the preacher that I ever received. A great detour. What makes you change direction in your life? Have you ever seen a detour sign on the highway? Do you all observe those detour signs, or just plug ahead? I remember Hurricane Agnes. Some of you are old enough to remember Hurricane Agnes. Came through the Middle Eastern states, came through Cockeysville. I lived on Sherwood Road then, back in the day when at the base of Sherwood Hill was the Cockeysville Underpass. Anybody remember that one? There was a sign there that said, "Impassable." And you know what people did? They said, "I can drive through that." And people drowned in the underpass because they refused to heed that detour. We're going to look a little bit about detours. First, we're going to look at these stories. Now, if you've been here on Epiphany Sunday before, which some of you have, you read the same stories every year, but we've got to put them in context. If you really want to understand Scripture, you have to look at it as it was written, where it was written, in that context, because we'll never know what it means to us now until we know what it meant to them then, one of the great lessons of Bible study. So, we have some passages, beginning with our call to worship, which was scriptural this morning. Kings along the Mediterranean coast, the kings of Tarshish and the islands, and those from Sheba and Saba will all bring their gifts. Yes, kings from everywhere, all will bow before him, all will serve him. Then Isaiah, that great passage about the arising and shining, because our light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon us. For darkness shall cover the earth, and thick darkness the peoples, but the Lord will arise upon you. His glory will appear over you. Nations shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. And what are they going to come with? They're going to come with gifts like gold and frankincense. Where have we heard that one before? Now here we see kings coming. And then in Matthew's gospel, we hear wise men came from the east. What else do we call these wise guys, these travelers from the east? What else do we call them? Magi. Do you all know what magi do as a living? They study the stars. They're sort of astrologers, more so than astronomers, although they looked at the stars to figure out when it was going to rain, when things were going to happen, to determine scientific things. But they also looked to decide things that were happening in the world that were different. And if you've ever read your horoscope, which some of you have, I'm sure, I know I have at some points in my life read my horoscope, that's what astrologers do. They look at the stars and say, this means that this is going to happen to you. How many of you have ever listened to your horoscope? Anybody ever made your decisions based on your horoscope? We've had presidents who have done that, who had astrologers in the White House tell them what to do on a certain day. Now, what's the problem with this if you're a good Jewish person? You're not allowed to do stuff like that. You're not supposed to read your horoscope if you're a good Jewish boy or girl growing up, because you don't trust things like that. Now look at Paul, who wrote the letter to the Ephesians, when he is in a different state. When Paul in the Acts of the Apostles, I think it's the 16th chapter, goes to Philippi, there's a little girl who follows him around going, servant of the Most High God, servant of the Most High God, servant of the Most High God. She had a spirit of divination, the ability to tell the future. And her owners, she was enslaved, her owners made a lot of money because people would pay her to tell them how their crops would fare and how their investments would do. Paul healed her, not out of compassion, because he was tired of being harassed. Turned around and said, get out of her. And ended himself up in jail in the city of Philippi because of that. Not a thing Jews are supposed to do, to use different things to tell the future. But isn't that what prophecy sort of does sometimes? Prophecy tells us what's going to happen based on the word of God. And that's what we have here. Now, if you look at Isaiah again, those beautiful lines, arise, shine, your light has come, the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. When was that written? The 60th chapter of Isaiah. Anybody here know that one? That was when the people had gone back where after their years in exile? They went back to the holy city of Jerusalem. They'd been out for nearly 60 years in exile. They go back all excited because their children have never seen their homeland. Their grandchildren, in some cases, have never seen their homeland. In all cases, never seen. In some cases, their children were not born then because it was almost 60 years that had passed since they had been home. They go back, and what do they find but destruction and desolation? They find their temple destroyed. Sad situation, but what are they called to do? They're called to be radiant and their hearts to thrill and rejoice, because the abundance of the sea shall be brought to you. The wealth of the nation shall come to you. A multitude of camels shall cover you, the young camels of Midian and Ephah. All those from Sheba shall come, they shall bring gold and frankincense, shall proclaim the praise of the Lord. Which should have rang a bell for those at the time of Jesus' birth, especially for King Herod. Can anybody tell me anything about King Herod the Great, King of the Jews? Oh, you really need to know about Herod if you want to understand this passage in its fullness and what we read last week about Herod being so afraid of one baby boy that he destroys all the children age 2 and under in the city of Jerusalem. Herod the Great, his father converted to Judaism. He was part Jew, part Roman citizen, and Mark Antony was his dad's best pal in the world. Julius Caesar gave him his kingdom. And Mark Antony was the one who gave him more land, even some of his girlfriend's land. You remember Mark Antony's girlfriend? What was her name? Cleopatra, ringing any bells for you right now? He gave Herod some of Cleopatra's land, Herod's father, which was Antipater. He got some of the land that was going to be his son's. His son was made tetrarch, and then his son was made king. If you are made the king of the Jews, who should you be answering to, do you think? Like if you're elected to Congress, who should you be answering to? should you be answering to? The people, your constituency. But Herod answered to only one authority, and that was the Roman emperor. And the Roman emperor loved Herod because he was good at one thing. What was he really good at? You can figure this one out, right? Collecting money, getting taxes, shaking down these people. He was not there for them. He was there for himself. And one thing he did do, he restored the temple in Jerusalem, but he did that more to put on a show, to show the people that he could be trusted. Because at the same time, down the road, he built himself a big, beautiful palace that still stands to this day. At least part of the walls of the palace stand. If you've ever been able to go to the Holy Land, you've been able to see Herod's palace. Some of you have seen it, I think. But what is it that we're told that this is going to happen? If you go back to the psalm again, the kings shall come and they'll bring gifts. Yes, kings from everywhere. They'll bow down before him and serve him. Who is him but our God? He will take care of the helpless and poor when they cry to him, for they have no one else to defend them. He feels pity for the weak and needy, who will rescue them. He will save them from oppression and from violence, for their lives are precious to him. And this is the time of the deep darkness that has been upon the people, but their light has come into the world in Jesus Christ. The problem is what? Their own king doesn't recognize who he is. It takes strangers from another land coming in, saying, we saw his star, it's rising. We've come to worship him. And Herod is so threatened by a little baby boy. Says Herod was frightened and all of Jerusalem with him. He wasn't frightened because he thought something strange was happening in the sky. He was frightened that he might lose his power over the people. He might lose his wealth and his prestige and his position that was given to him, not by his own people, but by Rome. So here we have this group of people traveling. It wasn't three. Now, if you go home and look at your Christmas cards, if you still have them, if you haven't tossed them out for the year yet, which I'm sure some of you have, but if you have them, I bet you have a multitude of cards with three guys on camels in silhouette with a star in the sky wearing crowns heading across the desert, right? The only time you ever see those three kings arriving at the manger is in a children's Christmas pageant in a church, because you gotta have more parts, right? There are three guys wearing crowns. You can't leave them out. They didn't get there for nearly 2 years. Jesus is in a house, and they go into the house with his mother Mary. They pay him homage. They open their gifts, and they offer him these gifts that show that they know who he is, even if the king of the Jews doesn't know who he is. Because this is the true king who has come into the world, Jesus Christ. And then they open their gifts, and they give him those precious, precious gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. And they don't go back to Herod because why? They've been warned in a dream not to. How many of you had a weird dream last night? I had a really weird one. Anybody have a weird dream last night that you can tell in church? Mine was I was preaching Christmas Eve in a church I'd never been in. I was in the basement and I was preaching. And I thought, wow, the overflow crowd was in the basement. Well, why am I not preaching in the sanctuary? I went up to the sanctuary. There was Julia Roberts in full costume. I was told thank you for being in our movie. Weird, huh? The one I had the night before was weirder. I can't even say what that one was. That was really strange. You ever had a dream that was so stark and real and weird that you thought, wow? Anybody here ever think God spoke to you in a dream? I think on that one, right? Anybody here ever had the same dream as someone in your family? This happened to my mother and me a couple of times along the way. Sometimes parents and children, sometimes siblings will have the same dream at the same time. I don't know what happened, but this group of travelers, that would have been a great caravan of people. We don't know that there were three. We don't know that they were kings. We don't know that they were kings. Who wears a crown in the desert when you're on a camel? Nobody, unless you're on a Christmas card or in a play. You wear your crown across the desert. Now, how many of you have put your creche away, your nativity set at home? Or is it still up? Did it get put up? Mine's in the closet this year because I had a bed in front of the closet. Whoops, I forgot to get that out when Frida and Tom came to help me clear out the room for my mother's hospital bed. But what do you notice about the kings in your, or the wise men in your nativity sets? What do they look like? Ever paid attention to them? Usually they're different colors, a little different in ethnicity. One is usually very dark skin, one is very light skin, one is sort of in the middle between the two. You have to put it away, go home and look at it and say, well, gosh darn, she's right. Because these are the nations coming to Christ at this time. The nations are coming to Christ, and that's why Paul writes what he does in his letter to the Ephesian church. Ephesus, modern-day Turkey, not in the Holy Land, per se. But he talks about bringing the word of God, the mystery of Christ, not to just the Jewish community, but to all of humankind. That is, the Gentiles have become fellow heirs, members of the same body, shares in the promise of Christ Jesus through the gospel. And of that gospel, he has become a servant according to the gift of God's grace given to him by the working of God's power. So all these stories do fit together, don't they? You've got to look what happens in the stories to understand. What does it mean for us today? We're the Gentiles. We're part of that group that was brought in to the people of God in Jesus Christ, to the Jewish community, expanded then through Jesus coming into the world. We're the ones who are now the church. We're the sign for other people to go a different way. So we talked a little bit about detours. What is it that makes you go a different way? What would make you change your direction on a road? Would you change direction if you saw a sign that said detour, or would you just want to see what's happening up ahead? I had some slides this morning that I put together and forgot to send to Barry. I had one great one from The Wizard of Oz that said, I'd turn back if I were you. How many of you would turn back if you saw a sign like that? How many of you would have to see the hole in the road to believe that it was really there? What about in life? What are the signs that tell us we're going the wrong way in our lives? Maybe think of one. If your doctor says your blood pressure is too high, what are you going to have to do about that? Got some options, don't you? Keep going the way you're going and get really sick, have a stroke or a heart attack and die. That's one way to go, right? If you go plowing through that. What's another thing you can do if you're told your blood pressure is too high? Change the way you eat, change your exercise, or you can start taking medication. That's one way that you can take a detour in your life. What about in your spiritual life? If you're going the wrong way, what is it that changes your heart and your mind? I hope for all of us is having an encounter with Jesus Christ. For one of his people, because the church can now be the sign that says we need to go a different way together. What do the drums up here say about us? I know some of you don't like looking at them. I've heard that. Oh, I've heard that. What does that say about us? So we have drums in this sanctuary now. What does it say? We're different. We got different music. We got an organ and we got drums. We don't play them at the same time usually. Maybe we can find a good organ drum piece. Rhonda, you might know one. Could happen. But it says that we're willing to do things in a new way to attract other people to the faith. It's a good thing to attract new people to the faith in Jesus Christ. But I hope some of us maybe have a change in direction in our heart. I was in college planning to be a famous writer. That was my goal. I didn't want to teach English. I wanted to be the new incarnation of some great author. I wanted to be Flannery O'Connor reborn, or William Faulkner especially. I wanted to be like that. But then God said, nope, got something else in mind for you. I was like, no, I don't want to go that way. And God said, this is the way you're going to go. And I went that way, and it's made the difference in my life. But you got to look for these detour signs, and that's why we are called to shine with the radiance of Christ. We are called to open our hearts to each other, because arise, shine, your light has come, the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. Then what are we called to do? Then we shall see and be radiant, your heart shall thrill and rejoice, because we are called to be the light to other people. I hope that you will understand what God has done for you in Jesus Christ this holy season. Because Epiphany is not just, it's kind of a season. They don't call it a season. We'll have the Sundays after Epiphany, which lead up to Lent. We'll focus on the light coming into the world. We'll focus on light and darkness. The world is a dark and scary place sometimes for lots of people. People who don't have the economic opportunities that we have. People who are sick. people who are grieving, people who are hopeless, people who are dying, who need us, who need our message of hope and peace and comfort and joy. So get out there and shine, arise and shine, people, because you may be the person that leads someone else to Jesus Christ. So look at the way you're living. You got to go a different way. Go a different way. God's going to open that way for you. Do not keep going if the sign says deep water ahead. I'm telling you, do not do that. What year was Hurricane Agnes? Was that 1970, 71, something like that? 72. 1972, I was, how old was I? I was 14 years old, and I remember seeing them taking bodies from the Cockeysville underpass. Don't be the person taking the body out. Don't be the body coming out. Go in a new direction when God sends you a message, because it doesn't always come through the church, does it? Those travelers from the east were not Jews. They weren't Christians. And yet they could recognize what their own king could not, because he was more concerned about keeping his power than he was doing what he was called to do in the name of the people. So we are called to love one another. We are called to show grace to one another, to forgive one another, lift one another up. And if you do those things, you will be the detour sign that sends somebody in a new direction in their life. To the glory of God and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Amen.